Yo, ladies and gentlemen, I'm MC Simmy, and welcome back to Space Engineers Weekly Workshop Roundup number 17. As always, I'm bringing you three of the hot ships and three of the hot mods from the Space Engineers Steam Workshop page. Well, this time, not for the last week, because there are some real-life circumstances that got in the way, which mean that all of the stuff in this episode is actually pretty old by this point. Long story short, I had a medical procedure and I was out of town twice, all with like half the footage recorded, so I just decided to plunge ahead with all the stuff that I was going to review anyway and bring it to you because, well, you know, it's just I already had it, so why not go ahead and feature it? So it's going to be interesting because we actually have quite a lot of great stuff here in this long episode, so let's get started. First up is Ship Parachutes by DraygoKorvan. There are reported multiplayer issues. Korvan is looking into them, so if you're looking to use this on a multiplayer server, then don't just yet. But well, it does what it says on the tin. It adds parachutes to Space Engineers, which in itself is a simple concept, but there's so many possibilities in my mind, really can't even begin to get around them. What I use them for, as we see just a close-up shot, but what I use them for was actually like as emergency chutes in case of a loss of power. So you could just deploy the chutes and sort of land. In fact, we're coming up to that right now. I took a Typhoon Osiris, one of my Typhoon Osirises, and I put four parachutes on it just to see what happened. Super, super interesting idea here. I do have to commend Drago for filling in this gap that really, you know, I didn't even know existed before. It's crazy. So yeah, four parachutes for the Typhoon Osiris. And yeah, it's crazy effective, as you can see. So once you got all that done, you just add the parachutes. Well, what I did was I put them in a group and then added them to the hotbar there, and then I turned the inertia dampeners off to simulate a loss of power, and I turned them back on to avoid smacking into that cliff face, but I turned them back off, and then I deployed my chutes. And well, as you can see, it's the chutes are sort of letting us drift slowly to the ground, 11.6 meters per second. They don't completely stop you, and they don't slow you down really enough to avoid damage, but they definitely get the job done if you're using them as emergency chutes. Now, speaking of possibilities, there are just a number of different possibilities. Like I said, you can, for instance, I saw one comment on this mod where the guy said that he was going to use them as parachutes for shock troopers, like Halo ODSTs, that sort of thing. And yeah, that was one of the possibilities. And yeah, like I said, doesn't really get you stopped enough to avoid damage, but the critical part is that the cockpits avoided damage. Even if we lost all of our reverse thrusters, the cockpits avoided damage, because the way these parachutes work is that I believe the center of mass has something to do with it. So like if they're behind or ahead of the center of mass, it determines which way the ship sort of hangs once you deploy the chutes. Another test run here, pretty much the same sort of scenario. Deploy the chutes, super high speed. Thank goodness they don't snap, at least in this update. So that way you could pretty much enter the atmosphere as quickly as possible and then just deploy your chutes and, you know, not have to worry about really sort of anything. And you can also cut the chutes if you were to, say, regain power just by closing them by pressing whatever number you have assigned to the chutes again, and then you willed them to repack them. So this is a test of you know, how they handle when deorbiting. So I'm coming from God knows how high up, and well, I've deployed the chutes, and they don't actually deploy until you hit atmosphere, which I thought was actually kind of cool, that little sort of detail, which means that they're not sort of a catch-all for whenever you screw up or something. So yeah, parachute mod, super awesome idea. And speaking of super awesome ideas, we are moving on to the DX11 passage airlock by Eikester. DX11, of course, meaning DirectX 11 compatible. And well, we don't have much footage of this mod because it does exactly what it says. It's a passage where one door is always closed, which keeps air in. So basically no more super complex, like big old huge airlocks. You don't really have to worry about your airlock design. It's all very compact right here. Just super simple. And I put some some passage blocks there, just so you can see exactly how well it sort of fits in to the sort of passages stack. Yeah, you don't really need much on that one. Super cool. Now we're moving on to Planet Irene 1C by Space Mining Universal. Man, this is just a beautiful planet. It's extremely difficult to explore, as we'll get to in a second, but it's just gorgeous. Absolutely gorgeous. I love the green haze and the sort of black ground. It feels extremely alien. That's the big sort of vibe that I get just looking at this. It feels alien. It just feels like foreboding. And of course the alien world music doesn't really hurt that sort of tense, foreboding atmosphere that it has either. And yes, it's just a little planet that's covered in peaks and valleys and sort of miniature lakes and stuff like that. Very topographically varied. And I'm not sure, for the record, I'm not sure what sort of like minerals and stuff, well, not minerals, but sort of like resources there are within the planet. But yeah, it's just gorgeous to sort of fly over and to walk around, although walking around in here is actually, well, borderline impossible. Now, I tried to paste a mastodon in here just to sort of explore it, and well, it went about as well as last time we tried to explore a planet. It couldn't move. As you can see, the planet makes 1.7 g's of gravity, so the mastodon, already a slow lumbering vehicle, of course that extra 0.7 g's just makes it so that can't move. So I pasted Jacqueline, the big old thruster on the back, and well, that's sort of, that moved a little bit, but not all that much. So yeah, you're not gonna explore this with a land vehicle, unfortunately. That sucks, because this seems like the sort of planet that you'd want to explore, like with a big old huge lumbering sort of truck just on a ground level. It would be very challenging. It'd be a great off-roading sort of experience. Yeah, so once again, pacing Osiris, and just decided to go for a little bit of a fly above the ground and just marvel at whizzing past underneath, because it's gorgeous. Like, it's just absolutely beautiful. It's not as beautiful as the sand plant that we reviewed last episode, but it is still just gorgeous in its own sort of alien way. It's such a nice planet to explore, shall we say. And I could spend hours hours just sort of looking around and seeing all these different sort of landmarks, as natural landmarks and everything, these valleys, these lakes and everything. It's filled with a lot of interesting stuff, especially when you go up high and it looks kind of like a moon. Because it's got sort of these big old huge craters and things. Hugely visually interesting planet. It's a shame that you can't explore on ground level, but yeah. So, speaking of vehicles, absolutely worthless, well, not absolutely worthless, but, you know, speaking of vehicles, the Dawnstar battle tank by Ravric. This thing. Oh, this thing. I cannot put it into words. You look at it and you think, oh, it's just a tank. You know, it's just a plain old tank. But what else is there to be said about it? Guys, this is not just a plain old tank. It's anything but a plain old tank for reasons that we shall discover in a minute. But we're flying up and over it just to sort of get a general look at it. Pretty well armed. It's got a missile launcher and that gat on the top on the turret there. And it's got two cockpits, actually. It's got one in the front and one in the back. So, supposedly, you could have the one in the front be your driver, the one in the back would be your gunnery sergeant, or something like that. And then on the bottom here, we just got to sort of look at sort of the underpinnings of the ship. A little bit of refueling connector. Those are always nice. And a couple of extra wheels on either end just to help with the off-roading capability. So, yeah, this thing, like I said, it's got enough firepower. It's pretty balanced. It doesn't have, like, an extreme amount. Like I said, one missile launcher and a gat to the side, a little camera up on the turret there so you can sort of see where you're aiming, which is always nice. The turret is pretty responsive. But it does kind of suck that you can't really pilot and you can't really drive and shoot at the same time unless you have a driver and a gunnery sergeant. And obviously it's all heavy armor too, so it's going to be able to take a fair whack, as we're about to see right now. Just a couple of shells to the side of another one. Now, we did have a big sort of tank battle planned with me and Koenigscobra and one of his friends that he brought over, and it was gonna be awesome and super fun and everything, but this game had all sorts of bugs while we were filming, which is another reason I couldn't quite get this out in time. So yeah, I mean, just all sorts of bugs, network problems, you know, tanks being spaced, everything like that. But yep, after a pretty good volley, you can see some of the damage that was done there. Managed to get past the heavy armor, knock one of the wheels off. It's still pretty functional though. I mean, I don't believe I got to the reactor, so you could still drive the tank around and sort of get your butt out of there. But You might be asking how this thing is to drive. There's no soft way of putting it. It sucks. It's awful to drive. It's just got too much power, and the vertical center of gravity of the turret is entirely too high. That's the first of many, 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 many rules I had in this filming session. So I pasted another one in. Yeah, that's no good. So I pasted another one in just so I could, you know, get a better feel for how it off-road, because I lost the turret and a couple of other things when I rolled it over. Yep. Every time I roll, I want you guys to take a drink. Every time I put the tank on its lid, I want you guys to take a drink of something, preferably soda, because if it's alcohol, you're probably gonna die of alcohol poisoning. It's insane. It's just too fast without the thrusters. Once you put the thrusters on, that's twice. Yeah, that's the second roll. This time I go a little bit air, and I believe I eventually get this one back onto its wheels. Yep. And I make a little bit of recovery, and then I do another roll, so that's three. In fact, I'll probably wind up putting a roll counter in here at some point. If I don't, you know, you'd probably be able to tell by how many sips you've taken of your drink already. So, there you go, that's three, almost four, and then it goes back. Not quite. Managed to get stopped and back on its wheels. I just want to see how this thing off-roads. That's the biggest thing. I want to get over there and see how it off-roads as we go for a fourth one. Yep. And back on the wheels. And then back over. That's five. Yeah, that's just... I got to the point where I was like, please stop. Please stop. I mean, it would be brilliant. It'd be brilliant if you managed to actually get it to go six for more than a few yards at a time without rolling over. Once you turn this thing with any sort of speed, it just goes over immediately. And I think it's because of that turret at the top. You know, this game doesn't handle attached grids very well, seven. Yeah, I think it's just because of the way that Space Engineers handles grids that have been attached to one another. So, yep, and then that is eight. Once again, back onto the side. And this is what the thrusters are for. Like, if you get stuck up on its side or something, you can cut the thrusters on, and they'll allow you to roll it back onto its wheels. Thank goodness for those, huh? Thank goodness for those. It's ridiculous. This thing is absolutely the hardest vehicle that I've ever had to pilot. It can be blazing fast once you master it, but you can't take a turn with any sort of speed. Otherwise, you'd be up on your turret in no time flat. And of course, I believe if you manage to somehow get to stay on its wheels for more than 4 seconds, it would actually be pretty good at off-roading because it's got the thrusters pushing it down into the ground, helping it get more traction, helping it get upwards. And then it's obviously also got the tires that sort of can roll onto to deal with more severe gradients. So yeah, there's still no reason. In fact, this is a perfect example of its off-roading potential, just going down a sheer cliff, no problem, like, at all. There's no reason to not download this thing. I believe that's nine? Yeah, there's no reason to not at least give this a try, I don't think, because, like I said, if you spend some time with it, more time than I had to spend with it, at least, you could probably make it into a pretty effective tank and a pretty effective off-roader at that. And yeah, I do get a little bit stuck here, but I managed to get myself freed eventually. Not the tank's fault, it's my fault for sort of misjudging exactly how steep that sort of ridge was there. But yeah, many fun times to be had with this tank in one form or another. It's just me, I couldn't pilot to save my soul, and that's nine. I believe we're gonna go for another one. Nope. So that's nine, and then, well, I almost got the hang of it, and then this happened. I could probably go out for a drink, go out, come back and get a drink. In fact, I'm gonna do that. I'm just gonna run to my fridge outside, come back, and see if it's done by the time I get back. Thank you. Well, I'm back and this damn thing is still not done rolling. Okay. Well, yeah, it's crazy. This just sums it up. This just sums up the time that I had with this tank. It was actually pretty fun. Type help into the chat box. That about sums it up. The Dawnstar battle roll tank by Ravric. But now we're moving on to things that are a little bit less rolly and flippy upside down. This is the U.A.S. Summer's Eve, part of the S series of ships by War Wolf. Yep, very utilitarian, sort of like a corvette sort of thing. It's decently well armed. It's got a few missile launchers, a few Gats, I believe. But it's more geared for speed and maneuverability. And let me tell you, this thing is actually very fast. It's extremely fast. And it comes in its own world because it's got a whole bunch of mods and everything. A little bit of a top shot here. Looks absolutely majestic from the top, I believe. I mean, it's a good looking ship, regardless of what angle you see it from. But I believe the top is actually one of its stronger sort of angles, stronger sort of sides. Pretty nice livery with that red and white. It looks like a fast ship. That's the thing. It looks like a sports ship almost. Like you could take some of the Gats off and everything, and it just would look more like sort of a sports kind of yacht, kind of large ship thing. Nice looking ship. Absolutely great looking ship. The exterior, however, is not the best thing about it, if you can believe it. The best thing about it is the interior. And so you saw the airlock on the side as we flew past there. That's where you can change into your suit for going outside. And yeah, flying through, pretty simple navigation. It's a combination of linear hallways and the elevator at the back that you just saw. So going to the left out of the airlock, you come through cryo here, kind of dark blue, you know, gorgeous. Just, yeah, look at this. I just love this sort of militaristic aesthetic that this ship has going for it. Like, on the inside, you can tell that this is a ship that's built for pure speed. There's no fancy stuff here. There's no, like, there's nothing for comfort, basically, like, at all. Pretty much the only comfortable thing about this ship is the fact that the cockpits have padding on the seats. I absolutely love when creators do that with their ships. Of course, I like luxurious ships also for when you just want to chill out. That was navigation. And this is actually the battle sort of tunnel thing that the whole ship has running through it. So you can go through those airlocks and it leads to different sort of parts of the ship. You don't have to worry about the slow elevator, you know, like if you need to get to different parts. The elevator is actually kind of weird. So that button over there is to reverse, or is to start it. And then the button on the left is to reverse it, you know. So the button on the right starts and stops, the button on the left left reverses. It doesn't have any sort of system where, like, it automatically stops once it gets to a certain floor or anything like that. So if you want to go to floor 2, you have to be pretty precise. We're down on floor 1. This is the bottom of the ship, and you've got a little bit of an area at the back here. This is a pretty interesting little sort of area. You got two branches that we'll get to in a second, but I believe, I'm not sure what this area is actually, but I believe it's some sort of inventory management sort of deal. So you got your inventory on the left, some other screens on the right, and you know, the two Colt command console packs, and then this sort of thing here And then that screen, that static screen. Yep. It's just those screens just add a little bit something to this part of the ship, I think. Of course, the Colt Command Console pack adds something to literally anything. Literally anything that's put in. You could just put it next to a gray block, and that's like your entire ship. And it looks awesome because you added a Colt Command Console. That's how highly I think of the Colt Command Console pack. So if you want to tickle my love bone, not like that, but if you want to make me review your ship, then put a Colt Command Console pack in it. And it's pretty much guaranteed as long as it gets on the first two pages of the Steam Workshop. Now these sort of tunnels here are just weird. I don't know what the stuff is to the sides. I don't know why it's all glowy and stuff. It's just strange. It looks like a place almost out of 2001 Space Odyssey to me. Except it's a little bit too red. It's not white enough. And then you get to this very weird airlock where like one door is immediately after the other one, like not even a block space in between. That was sort of trippy. And then you come to these engineering areas. You got, I believe, was it two reactors in each engineering area, and a couple of batteries, I believe. Yeah, they look well, just like the rest of the ship. They look very utilitarian, very basic, but like I said, serves the aesthetic of the ship absolutely perfectly. And then coming around the elevator, this is the locker area where you can just, well, you, I say the locker area, it's actually the armory. So you got, you know, your sort of weapon displays there and your lockers for your combat gear. And then we're going to move straight through, well, the combat gear area. I'm not sure why that would be separate from the locker area, because I believe those lockers allow you to change your astronaut suit anyway. And then we come through here, and I'll admit, I'm not 100% sure, but I'm 99% sure that this is inventory management. I kind of have to do my own research on these ships, so sometimes I'm a little bit unclear on what exactly certain rooms do. I didn't actually bother pressing those buttons there, unfortunately, so I kind of wish I knew what those did. And then we come to the battle hallway thing, and that obviously leads up to the bridge. So, speaking of the bridge, why don't we head there right now? Yeah, this is the bridge, and it's just intoxicating. It's freaking awesome. The sort of orange glow just adds a little something, I believe, to this bridge. You got your navigator, probably your gunnery sergeant, and then front and center, a la McLaren F1, you have your captain. And you got some sort of ship system information here. You can see all your gyroscopes. Uses gyroscope times 10s. Otherwise, probably wouldn't have enough gyroscope strength to be able to turn, let's be quite honest. And then some other information up next to the captain. So if you're sitting there and you're in first person view, you can sort of use Alt to look left and right and see how your ship's doing. Kind of an innovative little idea there. And yeah, just a little sort of panning shot from one console to the next. Yeah, I approve. I approve of this bridge wholeheartedly. It's pretty freaking epic. So let's hop in and take the Summer's Eve for a little bit of a fly, shall we? Yeah, look at the gyroscope strength. That's ridiculous. That's absolutely ridiculous for a large ship. And of course, the acceleration is just, yeah, absolutely breathtaking. Absolutely stunning acceleration from the U.A.S. Summer's Eve, especially when you see that it weighs the better part of 15 million kilograms. 15 million kilograms, and this thing steers and flies a lot better. I should actually say better than most small ships that I freaking tried on this show. It's crazy. It's crazy how that happens. So we're just taking a little bit of a cruise to planet side here. I was actually kind of surprised at how easy this thing was to land planet side, even without the use of parachutes. Wink, nod. Yeah. It's got, I guess, even though it's using ion thrust as its sort of upwards thrust, I guess it's just got enough of it to sort of counteract planetary gravity. Not exactly sure what that sound is. Weird sound. But yeah, I believe that's the upwards thrusters firing. But it's so easy to land, as we're about to see. Yep, just dropping it down planet side. And, well, there you go. I don't know what the sensors were. It's probably some sort of a landing mode to brace certain things for impact and to activate, deactivate certain things to make sure the ship doesn't get damaged landing planet side. But, hey, perfectly clean landing. Absolutely no damage at all because of those mighty modular thrusters on the bottom there. Yeah, super ship. I really can't think of one thing that this ship would be bad at. Probably wouldn't be very good in a fight, if I had to guess. But, yep. Yeah. So, this is the Terminus-class heavy frigate by Koenigscobra. Oh, yeah. You remember back in Space Engineers Weekly Workshop Roundup number 6? That awesome, awesome luxury ship, battle cruiser sort of thing that we had. Well, Cobra has one-upped that, and I dare say that was one of the best ships we've ever had on the show, and we've reviewed over 40 ships here, and that was one of the best. That was absolutely one of the best. He's beating it, guys. He's just beating it with the Terminus, I think. And of course, he's got his signature Atheris Shipyards livery, white, dark gray and green are the orders of the day. Almighty freaking mainsail thrusters. I mean, this Koenigscobra, yeah, he knows how to pick them. He's got a Titan thruster, which itself is badass enough, but he's also got 8 Sage industrial thrusters in case that wasn't enough for your candy. As a result, this thing is just as fast as, if not faster than, the U.A.S. Summer's Eve. This thing is ridiculously fast in a straight line. Turning, well, it weighs about twice as much as the Summer's Eve, so no, it's not going to be as good at turning at all. But really, I can't find an angle from which this ship looks bad. It's just all strong angles. I like this this shot coming around the nacelle. Here it's got a lot of depth and everything, and it just shows off sort of the overall size of the ship absolutely perfectly. This sucker is huge. Like, you look at it, and like I said last time, you look at it and you say, well, yeah, that's a big ship. Just wait till we get inside, guys. Just wait till we get inside. It's like massive. It's big on the outside, but even bigger on the inside. And I love ships that are bigger on the inside than the outside. Yeah, it's crazy. So, this is how you get in. First of all, you got the hangers on the insides here. They're well protected. They're protected from, well, pretty much all 4 different sides, unless, you know, you've got a super maneuverable fighter to come in from the top and the bottom and bombard the heck out of you. But, yeah, so there are buttons. They're just behind the gats there that we're about to find out just after we go under the ship. Yeah. Yeah. It's big. It's huge. It's massive. And this shot doesn't even begin to show you how big and massive it is on the inside. Now, I will warn you guys, I did miss a couple rooms because this thing is so big, and it's, admittedly, it's pretty confusing to navigate around. It's definitely one of those ships where you have to sort of get used to the sort of hallway navigation sort of thing. So it's gonna take a few minutes for you to just explore and sort of get around. And so yeah, the button, like I said, behind the turrets on each side starts this depressurization sequence and then drops this hangar door eventually. And it's got those flashing lights on the sides there. There goes the hangar door. And well, on the inside, we've got two hangars, like I said, and each one contains contains a Vipera fighter. Now, Koenigscobra's Vipera fighters are absolutely ridiculous. Never ever face a Vipera. Ever. Do not go up against a Vipera if you have the choice, because those things are absolutely ridiculous. So here's hangar oversight. And, well, more cult command consoles. Keen, you should really add those in. Like, you should hire Colt, and he should add those in to your game. That'd be super. That'd be amazing. So, flying back out of hangar oversight. Flying out of the hangar into the ship proper, we come to this hallway. And in this hallway, well, we have this door. And I'm not sure exactly what this is. This is probably some sort of, like, storage area. In fact, yeah, that's exactly what it is now that I think of it. You got some storage containers down there. They're hooked, I believe, to the overall conveyor system. And you got these shelves here with batteries and such. A couple of, like, little saws and probably a welder or two in there. So, nice little sort of detail there. And I like how it's sort of close to the hangar, so if you're like trying to repair a ship, you could just sort of run in, grab a tool, run out, and you know, just that's that. You've also got the lockers here, pretty nondescript. Just sort of, well, they're just lockers, like, what else do you need? And so coming out of that and into another doorway across, I believe, across the hall. This is actually the bathroom. There are a couple of these. In fact, I believe the ship's mirrored from left to right, so we're only exploring one side of the ship. So pretty much everything should be on the right side as well. And so yeah, you got your bathroom, you got your toilet, you got your shower. In fact, this is the toilet right here. You got your sink. Nice, spacious bathroom. Pretty luxurious, if I do say so myself. And then, yeah, I do want to bring up. I do like the sort of interior blocks up on the right side. The overall shape of the hallway. It's just sort of nice and cozy, I believe. And speaking of cozy, we are in the crew quarters. Very well outfit crew quarters. You got your dead tech stove. You got, you know, your sink. You got your place for your crew to eat. You've got four bunk beds with two pillows each, queen size, I believe. So, you know, four crew they hold, and you know, whatever alien love interest they pick up. Hopefully Asari, or maybe Corian. I'm not sure. I mean, I have Corian right here sitting next to me, the tally figurine. I'm not sure which I like best, though. But, so hanging a little bit further down to the end of the hallway, we come to this split here, and to this sort of airlock, to this sort of airlock area. It's got, well, it's your engineering, it's bang, it's got six reactors. It's got six reactors there. pretty big reactors too, the Azimuth, fusion reactors. Those are pretty brawny, so that gives you a sort of general idea of exactly how much power this ship requires. And then this is the common sort of hallway meeting area where everything sort of comes together from left to right. And it's a little bit confusing at first, but you come over here to the left or the right, you got your gyroscope area. That's a very, in fact, this is one of my favorite areas of the ship, just for how open it feels. It's a nice feeling sort of area. And you got all of your management consoles to keep an eye on your gyroscopics and see, you know, if one gyroscope, for instance, may be having a problem. Also, your gravity generator, one of your gravity generators, I should say, is down in here. And a couple of plants, because plants are nice. You know, plants are freaking awesome. A couple of timers, too, that I also notice. Yeah, it's a pretty nice looking area. You can't really expect anything else from Koenigscobra, though. And that's not just because, you know, we're sort of buddies. It's because he genuinely is, I believe, one of the best creators in the Space Engineers. The Space Engineers Steam Workshop. He's absolutely fantastic. He's one of the best in his craft, I dare say. So exploring, in fact, coming around behind this sort of, I believe, one of the staircases. Yeah, as you can see, it's, or as I told you, it's pretty convoluted to sort of explore this. But this is just showing you that, yeah, this is all mirrored left to right. So you go in one of those doors, you come out the other. And so now we're actually going down. To probably one of the best areas of the ship. We'll get to that in a second, though, because first we gotta check out this additional sort of, well, I say it's additional cargo area. I believe those are cargo containers. I could be wrong. I'm not exactly sure what those sort of are. I've never seen them, I don't think. They could be air vents. But, so yeah, just another little area with some tools and stuff. In case you need to fix something, you can come here and get a battery. But now, we're coming down, and I believe this is, well, yeah. This is sort of where all the sort of staircases meet together on the bottom floor. It's kind of hard to explain, but we're coming to the best break room, second best break room that we've ever seen. Well, I say second best break room. Second best, best outright break room. Yeah, I was thinking of that canteen from that one large ship that we featured on Space Engineers Weekly Workshop Roundup, but this break room, dude, this break room. Like, this is just seriously cool. You got a huge couch, you got, you know, a beautiful view out to the stars through the TVSI Tech diamond bonded glass out the bottom there. You've got a freaking ping pong table, but that's not even close to the most epic thing that's in this break room, guys. You got these weight benches here. So you can exercise while on the go. Little pool table so you can have a little bit of pool action in space, because why not? Pool's always awesome. Mortal Kombat 2, this is the most epic thing. Space invaders on a freaking spaceship, dude. That's how you do space. That's how you do space. So I'm just sitting here, you know, I'm chilling. And this is actually after I get the ship up to speed, as you can see. I just wanted to show you how, you know, you can get the ship up to speed and you can come down here and you can relax and just have a good old time on your journeys. So freaking cool. Like, so freaking cool. And then down here you can sort of walk down onto the TVSI Tech Diamond Bonded Glass and you can have yourself a nice look and see out to the stars. And then you can come over here and play yourself some Space Invaders on your freaking spaceship. That's cool. Like, that's hilarious. I was actually grinning from ear to ear when I saw that little addition that Koenigscobra made. Press a couple of buttons, using the joystick a little bit. You know, just playing some space invaders in space and space engineers. And then, once you get bored of space, invaders can come over here, play yourself some pool. And I knocked that ball into the corner pocket. Yeah, I'm a boss. I'm an absolute boss at imaginary pool, as you can probably guess. And I'm also a boss at jumping up onto the top, the very rim of couches. Yeah. Just absolute beast. Absolute beast break room. I love it. I love it to bits. Probably one of my favorite areas in a ship that I've ever seen. I'm not kidding. So now we're coming up to sort of the bridge-ish area. This is the captain's quarters. Pretty luxurious, as you would probably expect. You got your command consoles off to the side there so you can browse the internet, you know, and do sort of different space ship stuff. You got your bed here so you can take your alien lover to bed here, and it's pretty awesome. You got your couch there with your TV, and yeah, just sort of nice place to hang out. Nice, relaxing place to hang out and watch your favorite space engineer ramble about your favorite spaceship. Hopefully that would be me in this one. All right, so this is, this is sort of an area. I'm not sure what it is. I guess it's just sort of an x-ray because you got that sort of x-ray-ish looking sort of thing off to the side here where you can come and get a medical checkup. Speaking of medical checkups, this is the actual med bay. Very well outfitted, again. Some more command consoles because you can never have too many of those. Your actual med room off to the side for your respawning purposes. And if you come back here, you've got some sick... Well, sorry. You've got some sick beds. So, you know, if you're feeling a little bit ill, a little bit down under the weather, you can sort of just lay down, you know, and sort of hang out until you get to feel a little bit better. Maybe take some stuff to take the edge off, that sort of thing. Now we come up to the bridge, and what do you know? It's just as epic as everything else on this ship. It's huge, it's big, it looks super, like, freaking amazing. You can't expect anything else from Koenigscobra. Come on, guys, please download his stuff as much as you download Sage's. I'm telling you, Koenigscobra's Space Engineers Workshop page is where it's at if you want awesome stuff. I'm telling you that right now. But you got sort of these miniature areas off to the side. I guess one side would be navigation, the other would be systems maintenance or gunnery. Or whatever, because you got some other stuff up top in the main sort of bridge area, so you know you could also have those functions there as well. So, and of course, pretty decent view, not the best because you can't really see up or down that well. But yeah, here we go. Yeah, that's the acceleration that we're working with, guys. This ship weighs pretty much twice what the U.A.S. Summer's Eve weighs, and yet we're able to get up to 100 meters a second with literally no problem, pretty much. It's crazy how fast this thing accelerates. It's absolutely mind-blowing how fast this ship goes. Turning, like I said, not really the best, but hey, you got plenty of straight line speed. Absolutely awesome ship. Koenigscobra, you're the man. That was like just fantastic. That was amazing. That was great. But anyway, yes, I do apologize once again for this episode being so late and, you know, such a huge gap between episodes recently. I'm gonna try to do something about that, but you know, these things take multiple days to film, and more often than not, life just gets in the way. So, you know, I do what I can, do my best. But anyway, if you like this video, then go ahead and bitch up that like button. If you really, really liked it and you want to see more, go hit that subscribe button. Hey, I've been MC Zinman, you've been awesome. I'll see you guys in the next video. MCZ out.